Sí, más.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for staying with us for the second panel of the day that I think is going to be extremely interesting for you. My name is Cheryl Miller. I'm the founder and general director of the Digital Leadership Institute, and it's my pleasure and honor to moderate this wonderful session today with some very prestigious representatives of both the public sector and private sector in Europe. We will launch our panel with a keynote presentation by Luciano Floridi, who is a professor at the prestigious Oxford Internet Institute. Unfortunately and ironically, we are not able to show you his presentation, but I'm sure you've been in worse situations before. We're going to go analog at the Think Digital Summit. And I hope, although I'm not planning to spoil your presentation, that you can kind of lay the foundations for us in terms of the challenge that we are going to discuss today, which is thriving in a digital environment. Now, when I wrote to you about this session, I spoke about surviving in the digital environment, and in fact, some of us are not quite thriving. But I will leave that to you and take up the question following your presentation with the rest of the panel, Dr. Floridi.
Yes, I hope that the microphone at least works. Yes, I think that the indecent amount of time that I spent preparing these slides means that I have something of them in my mind still. So although you can't see what I'm going to see in front of me, I hope to be able to present some of the points that I thought might be of interest to start collecting ideas and the debate around this new digital environment or infosphere, just to introduce some terminology. Now, the first point that I want to share with you is that if you think that you go online, then you are like me. You were born in the 60s, because nobody today goes online, certainly not my students, because you are always constantly connected. So at the same time, if you think that you are totally constantly digital, then you must be a millennial, because of course you're not. So the mix between the online and the offline, this special space, is where essentially the sweet water of the river mixes with the salty water of the sea. In that place, asking, are you online, asking, is the water salty, is it sweet, means not having understood where you are. So this, and I had to check the English vocabulary, as you can tell from my name and my pronunciation, I'm European.
Proudly.
Exactly. I had to check on the British, on the OED, and the special water is called what is a brackish space. That's where the mangrove grow. You can't see the picture, they're beautiful. The mangrove society is what we're talking about here. It's complicated, and the second point that I'd like to introduce is that this mangrove society, we left it grow chaotically, thinking that the internet was just another utility. 20, 30 years ago, depending on who was in power at the time or was doing some thinking, misunderstood the internet for gas, electricity, water. And the thought at the time was, let it grow, we will regulate when necessary. We misunderstood, and I say we with a lot of kindness towards our politicians. They misunderstood the fact that we were building a new world, that this infosphere, these brackish waters, this mangrove society is where we spend most of our life today, and future generations will actually inhabit progressively more. It's a new space and therefore needs a lot of constructive regulations. It's not just another utility. And all the talking from, say, the major platforms saying we're just providing a service is, to say the least, in the best of all possible perspectives, comes from the 80s. is not 21st century talking. So in terms of the points that I want to share with you, and I'm aware that I have another maybe 7 minutes to go, so I'll be brief, there's another point that might help us here. It actually comes from Shakespeare. It's after 25 years in Oxford, a bit of Shakespeare is almost inevitable. There's a scene that you may recall, perhaps, in the Macbeth, when Banquo meets the three witches. And I got the quotation in front of me here, and he says, no, he meets the three witches. The witches can predict the future, and he says, if you can look into the seeds of time and say which grain will grow and which will not, speak then to me who neither beg nor fear your favors nor your hate. I have the guts of asking you about the future. You just have to tell me what will grow and what will not. Now, 2 points here. One, there's no necessity. If you've done any gardening, things don't just grow. No? No, yeah, there's a lot of effort. Call it socio-political effort to make sure that the good stuff grows and the bad stuff doesn't. And point two, there's a should here, which Banquo doesn't have. What should grow and what shouldn't? And that's where the normative component kicks in. That's where a advanced, mature, civilized society doesn't let things grow chaotically, but takes the lead in making sure that they grow in the right direction. It's not violent, it's caring. In the same way as we do gardening, we make sure that the right stuff grows and Trump doesn't. So, five ethical challenges here to come to the two-third, almost second half of the talk. And just five, because I have five fingers, we could multiply them in a number of ways. But I thought, because we have so many catchphrases around Internet of Things, big data, artificial intelligence, cloud computing, I thought we could just pick up something there in terms of what kind of planning we can do for the seeds of time. Number one, infosphere, or this space, as a social experiment. We need to start planning seriously good information behavior. Most people will be living in gigantic cities in about 20, 30 years. We're talking about possibly 70% of humanity. Again, the graphs is beautiful if you could see it. Oh, man. We get our smart environments, our social labs. We are experimenting on human beings first and then thinking. If you have a positive view of a Tesla being unleashed in a city, that is opening up a lab with humans as potential experimental targets. So that is the first thing. Now, how do we improve information behavior online? We got a little bit of understanding about information searching, slightly less about information seeking, and certainly almost nothing about information behavior. How we informational organism behave online. Point number two. Well, this infosphere, these brackish waters where the salty and the sweet waters mix, they are not all the same. There's the rural, the urban, and the hyper-urban areas here. And think in terms of smart cities. Well, when you see a smart city, normally a presentation, there's these beautiful buildings, fantastic sci-fi. People forget about suburbia, which doesn't sort of qualify there. So fairness and opportunities there in terms of making sure that we are all in the same waters is crucial, because a lot of that is either invisible or opaque, and only the salient makes it to the news. Only the downtown becomes the smart city. No good. We need to remember that the future will be a mess, where the old, the new, the obsolete and the futuristic will mix. Remember the waters there? There's a bit of sand, a bit of anxiety, and that's why navigating those waters is crucial. Point number three, remember there are five, almost there. I'm looking at the moderator, yes. Agency. Well, agency has been a new challenge for us. Of course, we have a human agent, but we also have the old-fashioned ones, biological agents, used to be horses in town, and of course the new ones, the artificial ones. What to do with the competition and collaboration between all these forms of agency is a crucial challenge. We cannot just let to the market to decide what it's going to be like. not because the market is evil, but because the market is short-sighted, doesn't have a plan, does not have a social view of what we want to have as a material society. So we need to collaborate with the market to make sure that this competition and collaboration works well. And then, picture, democracy and e-government. We have a bit of a mismatch these days between the top-down supply when it comes to digital services, digital products, digital goods, and the bottom-up demand. How many things you've seen that are totally wasted? And how many things that citizens want and we're not delivering? Realigning the e-supply and the e-demand is another challenge we need to meet. It's doable, it takes intelligence, a bit of effort, but it's around the corner. And in that context, I'd like to introduce another expression, which is tolerant paternalism. You want to be a bit paternalistic. I know the word doesn't have the best press. But remember, next time you go home and someone wants to jump out of the third floor and says, that's a bad idea. Be paternalistic, because putting the fingers into the socket, you're not going to recommend that to your child. At the same time, we want to be tolerant, because people need to be able to experiment. So how do we do this? How do we square this particular tolerant, let people do whatever they want, and paternalism, tell them what's right for them, give them information. Give them that special gate through which they have to take decisions informed. And then if they really, really, really want to jump out of the third floor, well, that's the window. But they need to know that when they land, they will have no chance. That's what has not happened, for example, in my own country with Brexit. We did not give people the right information. And what happened? Well, the window was open and we jumped. Last point, number five. We have finally reached a point where our ethical understanding of our environments is a bit more sophisticated. Good old days, at least a generation ago, it was the natural versus the artificial. The forest is good, industry is bad. No longer so. We have built the whole world. There's virtually nothing around us that is untouched by human presence, for good or for bad. So we need a synthetic environmentalism, where the E at the beginning is capital E-dash environmentalism. And that is where the digital can mediate between the artificial, the constructed, human-made, and the natural, what we found here to begin with on this planet. At this point, there's more that I could say, but I'm coming to the end, and looking at the time, we are doing fine. So four steps that we could take to make this a little bit less philosophical and a little bit more sort of traction on the ground. You want to check that your project, whether political, industrial, business, or academic, is feasible in terms of resources, of course. Within the feasible, you want to look at the environmentally sustainable. Exclude everything that is not environmentally sustainable. Within the environmentally sustainable, you want to look at what is socially acceptable, because if it isn't, it will fail. And within the socially acceptable, look at what is preferable, what people really would like to have when they think. The condition is crucial. Not when they want to go and eat all the sweets in the shop, because that's a bad idea, remember the paternalism, but when they actually have the information and realize, well, you know what, I need to be on diet. So on that conclusion, the final point is the following, and it will be an Italian philosopher that most of you will have never heard of, I hope. His name is Pico della Mirandola, and he wrote the Oration on the Dignity of Man, which is the manifesto of the Renaissance. There he said that we are neither angels nor brutes. Today we say no robots. We are an open, ongoing project, each of us, a kind of an open source software. As such, we need to make sure that we're building this new environment as friendly towards humans. Friendly in an intelligent way, friendly in a constructive way. So to conclude, I think what we really need to work today, at least as philosophers, is the following question, and I leave that to everybody to consider. What is the human project for the 21st century? Not the necessary conditions, not the GDP, not employment, not housing, because those are necessary conditions to get there. The question is, what is the there? What's the project for these necessary conditions to lead us there? Thank you so much.
Now you make me think that maybe just survival wasn't the objective. But I'm not going to answer the question.
But flourishing is.
Thriving is the objective. Well, at least for this panel. So maybe if we can start with that. And you see, in the meantime, our panel is complete. So I'm going to start with the panelists on the far end, being the last to join us. We have not yet done introductions, so to my extreme left. And the next to left, next to him. I'll let you all introduce yourselves, and then we'll get into some of the meat of the discussion, if that's okay, starting with you, Vice Minister De Croo.
So I'm Alexander De Croo. I'm Deputy Prime Minister and Minister for Digital Agenda and Development Cooperation in Belgium.
My name is Kaja Kallas. I'm a member of European Parliament elected from Estonia.
I'm the strategic advisor to our Minister for Digital Affairs and as well plenipotentiary of our Minister for our International Relations.
From Poland.
From Poland, yes, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And I'm David Goodridge. I'm head of European Acceptance and Government from MasterCard.
So as I said, we have quite an illustrious group of individuals gathered, maybe the brain trust around digital thinking in Europe, if I dare say so, representing some of the most forward-looking and forward-achieving economies in Europe, digital economies. And I think what the way I'd like to tackle the discussion is to focus first on, indeed, what our objectives are for the digital environment and how to thrive and flourish, and what, from a European collective perspective, we can offer the world stage on this question. There are certainly milestones that we have accomplished as Europe, but also individually, because we have an excellent mix of Europeans, if I may be so bold, being the outlier here, European, actually American-born. And maybe we can start with a private sector perspective, if you would be so kind, Mr. Goodridge, to tell us what your perspectives are on the on thriving in the digital environment, some of the challenges you've encountered, and what MasterCard is doing about building the and the challenges that you've encountered.
Yeah, thanks, Cheryl. I think from a MasterCard perspective, firstly, we do like to make sure people understand who we are and why we're here. So, yes, we are in the private sector, but we do very much consider ourselves a payments company in the technology space. So you probably all agree, and we certainly heard it from the keynote at the beginning there, that we are living through very interesting times. You know, we certainly position it in our company as we're living through the fourth industrial revolution. Digital technology, the way that that is impacting people's lives makes a difference to everything they do. You know, I look at my own life, I look at my my tablet, my two phones, my connected device, my watch, and for me, it comes down to, well, what does that mean? What does that impact on me and the way that I operate? And probably it's the same for many of you. It changes the way you interact, it changes the way you live your life, and that's how we're finding it at MasterCard as well. The biggest impact is the way that those connections form and take place. So we work across issuing banks, acquiring banks, merchants, retailers, and that interaction and that point of interaction is very much where MasterCard is at the center. But we always take the consumer view. It's always the consumer that we put at the heart of everything we do, and it's the consumer that's driving a lot of what we are doing right now. The connected consumer wants to connect, wants to shop, wants to buy, and wants to buy in a new way, in a different way than they have before. And that's meaning that we need to change the way we operate, and it means that we need to consider the solutions that we put in place for them in the different environments they're at. Very similar to the saltwater, seawater, through to the river. We see that it doesn't make a difference now if a consumer is online or in store, they are looking for an ability to pay and make that payment in a very converged way. The ability to seamlessly transact with their devices in whatever environment they're in. MasterCard is very much at the centre to be able to put those platforms in place to be able to facilitate that and make that work for them.
So what Dr. Floridi said about there's no question of being offline or online, I think this, particularly in the consumer space, fast-moving consumer goods, is really, and payments is really out there on the forefront of getting us connected and keeping us connected. Certainly there are some ethical questions around that maybe we can go into in a moment. But in the meantime, Mr. Schubert, would you like to share with us what you see as the growth of the digital environment from a Polish perspective? What kind of challenges you're encountering and the kind of groundwork that you're laying?
Yes, thank you. So we've been put actually in front of quite a lot of challenges at the beginning because our administration, the existing administration, is just 1 year old. I spent the last 20 years in business being entrepreneur, investor, and completely different perspective. So I was asked by our government, our minister, to help having these competences and experience to really help move things much faster. At the beginning, we've been put, as I mentioned, in front of quite a lot of challenges. So we had like 4,000 systems in place to really take care of and see what we can do with them. We had almost 140 data centers to take care of. We had a lot of different type of strategies and documents which we had in place. So very, very fast from the beginning, we realized that we need to put a very short and fast strategy in place to put out everything we have at the moment to really show the directions to the business people and in general where we will be going. And we decided to write together with our minister very directional strategy. We call that strategic priorities of Minister of Digital Affairs. This is a document in size like digital single market, not more than 20 pages, very strict and very, very clear. So it's easy to take in it one sitting so you can really understand where we'll be going. And to not go very much in details in this document, maybe we can do it later. It's actually based on five areas which we identified as the most important. So we need to have the infrastructure in place, any kind of infrastructure, but to get people to have the access to the new media, internet, and stuff like this, everything we will be talking about in the future. The second thing was the integrated e-services for the citizens or entrepreneurs or for the business people and all type of the e-systems, e-services which are integrated, they have to be in place as soon as possible. The third was competences on very different levels, starting from school, business, people, up to administration, because in our perspective, even if I'm from the business, the idea was to not let people within the administration to develop the systems. They have to be able to really order the system, have a knowledge about that, and then be able to receive the ready products in the right time and in the right condition. So it was the third. Cybersecurity getting to more and more important if you are going much more online, much more digital, and we are trying to build the portals which are integrated. And then European concept, area, all the documents, regulations, everything which is coming from Europe, which has to be also in our perspective, and the idea also to be much more active play on the European field, and that we are doing. So maybe I will cover that later, but this is the very, very basic background where we started.
Well, that's very comforting, I think, for everyone to hear that there is an active, proactive position on staying in Europe, staying engaged with Europe, exactly. Staying engaged with Europe digitally, which brings us, I think, a nice entry point for our member of European Parliament from Estonia. But if I may, I also wanted to share that there is a rather large spread among the panelists in terms of the Digital Economy and Society Index. And the panel is heavily weighted in terms of those that are more, do I say advanced, higher up on the scale on the DESI index, of which, of course, Estonia is one of the kind of rising stars. Do you want to tell us a bit about that journey and what there is for the rest of the group to learn from Estonia?
Yes. What we have done in Estonia, we already had digital identities in the year 2000. So we created the laws for that, and very many people, if you would have asked whether you want a digital identity, then the people would have said in the year 2000 that what is digital identity? But what we did, and actually that goes also what you said about the e-governance and democracy, that you have to have both sides. So you have to have the demand side as well as the offer side. So what we did, we created the digital services that the people can use their digital identities for, and so they had the motivation to take that up. And what is also important is that those digital services have to be end-to-end services. It can't be so that, you know, you can prepare the things online and then finally you still have to show up somewhere. So it creates frustration. And I think also what the first speaker said about how our behaviors have changed, I think this applies to the public services as well, that people are doing their things online and they want to have these things and they want to have access to digital services. So that applies to the governments as well. And in Estonia's case, we actually have created this system so that the companies can build on that. We have the e-residence, which means that every one of you can become e-resident and enjoy the digital services. So you can establish a company online in Estonia under 20 minutes, and you can also open bank accounts now. But what it needs is the government's idea of being a partner to the company, so being like enabler, not that you can't do this or whatever, we don't want to go into that, but no, we actually make these things possible. What are the obstacles? So what can we do in that respect? So it has to be taken into account that it's I think the behaviors of governments should change as well. It's not that hierarchy based anymore, because it's more flat.
Now, if I said Estonia is kind of a rising star, would it be fair, Minister De Croo, also from my second home country, I'm very proud of this fact, that Belgium is a cash cow in terms of the DESI index? We're actually calling Belgium lagging ahead, so in a position of prominence, but where the growth in terms of digitization and societal engagement through digital is slowing down now. Still, we're a pioneer. You are the minister, vice minister for the digital agenda for Europe, for Belgium, not yet Europe. are you alone in terms of that kind of role across Europe? Do you look across and see a lot of peers? How far ahead is Belgium? And what do you see now in front of you as the challenges you've got to tackle?
Well, let's not make it a competition between Kaya and myself. But we did have the electronic identity cards at the same moment as you had them. It's just that you did more things with them. So we've had them for 15 years as well, and unfortunately nobody uses them. And that's a learning to what you said, is that it needs to be end to end. Having just one piece of the puzzle is not really helpful. I think that what is important I think we need to have a discussion on what was said as an introduction about ethics and so on. I think it's an important element. Still, I think if you look at Europe today, I think the biggest issue is that there is somewhat of a contradiction, in the sense that I think a lot of people want to go forward with this digital life and see a lot of limitations everywhere to do so. And in another sense, people are being scared of this digital economy as well. And I think we should not underestimate this. We've seen some exotic election results over the last months. Exotic to some. And there's a lot of analysis on where is this coming from. I think there's a number of reasons, but I'm convinced one of the reasons is the huge technological change that we're seeing. And people are afraid. And I think rightfully so, because we're not giving them the tools. Estimations are that between 30 to 50% of the jobs are going to be automated in the next 10 years. That is scary. If you think about this further, is this really a problem? I do not think it is really a problem, because technology has over the last 100 years done nothing else than destroy informal, poorly paid, and not very interesting jobs and replace them with better jobs. Technology has done nothing else than create jobs. But explaining that to the public and making sure that they have the right tools to be part of that, I think they don't see it. And I think we are not giving them the tools for that. Now, it's hard to expect from anyone to be able to make bulletproof legislation and rules for the next 10 to 15 years, because it's hard to know in which direction it is going. But what we see in Europe is that, I think in general, legislation and the way we look at society and the way we look at technology is mostly based on distrust. Everything is built on, we don't trust people, and we should be limitative in what people can do. And I think if you look at the way society is evolving, I think it should be the other way around. I think the more freedom and the more trust you give to people, I think in general people do good things when you give them trust. Now, let's look at how we legislate. Up to now, mostly in Europe, legislation is made with one lens. We just stipulate what is allowed, and everything else is prohibited. And I think it should be the other way around. I think we need to be very clear on what we do not want. And there we need to be clearer. And all the other things, I think we should say, let's try it out. Let's try to find out. And if we need to intervene, we will intervene. If you look at the discussion about data today, we only talk about data protection. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't talk about data protection, but we should also talk about the benefits of data. And so today, with any discussion, we just get completely lost in a discussion about all the bad things that might happen. And in the end, nothing happens. The bad things don't happen, but the good things don't happen either. And that perspective, which is a perspective where we are more open towards innovation, but more clear on the effects that we don't want, I think that perspective, I do not see it enough in Europe all over, and I think it applies to Belgium, but it applies mm-hmm. to the whole of Europe. And that is a risk, and I would love to see that perspective more.
Well, maybe we can step back for a moment then from kind of the minutiae of digitization and look at this environment that we're mm-hmm. creating, because I think that's where the broad stroke If you can't legislate, create bulletproof legislation, then I guess what you ideally want is the informed lawmakers who create the environment to be able to respond to the reality on the ground. And then I think it is quite interesting, for example, that I have 50 cards. I have both the Estonian e-residency, I have a Belgian ID card, which functions as a lot more and more things day by day. But of course, I also have MasterCards and bank cards. And literally, when I lost one of them and had to put them all in a stack, I had a pile like this, which to me is an opportunity, right, for an entrepreneur. It's also a kind of missed opportunity where the private sector and the public sector could be possibly working better together. And this is where I'd like to come back to this half of the panel. I think given your private sector experience, also because MasterCard is really pushing the envelope as far as our digitization as people, what kind of, I'm not going to just let the comment rest that we should all be trustful, because I think the moment that we allow the private sector to just kind of legislate, remember when Google said, don't be evil? Remember that? No, you don't remember. That's been a long time. I want to talk about this delicate balance between, yeah, legislating and regulating, but also creating the fluidity between the public and the private sector that can help to build this environment in the digital age. Do you have something you want to...
Yeah, I think to me it's the partnership element. I think it's the partnership element between the private sector and government, and I think that's certainly been the approach that we've taken. You know, listening to the conversations about EID, this is a key platform that we've been developing and working on, and there's certainly solutions that we offer that can take that forward. You know, in Nigeria, as an example from further afield, you know, we have an EID product and proposition which is out there. It's the National ID Scheme. That was more about proof of life than anything, and actually taking a lot of fraud out of the system for the Nigerian government, an all-in-one solution where the EID not only gave the ID credentials of the individual, but also was used for payment of benefits and various other public sector elements. So again, I think the partnership element is absolutely key, but then also I think from a consumer perspective, the benefits that they will see in those environments when they are being able to really benefit from private and public sector working together. Mm-hmm. And I think there's some good examples we can share probably from Poland with regards to the work there, with regard to the digitization of the in-store economy, opening up new acceptance across Poland. For many years, Poland was our number one market for contactless transactions where cards could be used in-store with just a tap, and that opened up the whole economy. So it really drove a lot of that activity, and now we're doing similar on the digital side, and there's a collaboration going on right now, maybe worth referencing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead, tell us about it.
I will comment on that very soon, and one comment on what the Prime Minister said, because there was a very interesting point, because our Prime Minister for Development actually like a week ago announced the program which we are calling as Entrepreneurship Constitution. That's the word we are using there. But the thing is that the main rule is that what is not forbidden is allowed, yes, for business. So we completely change the way we are thinking about allowing businesses doing what they are intend to do. Regarding EID, we do not have it still, but we are working on that, so I hope we'll be able to deliver this project very soon. Next year we will be having the MID, the mobile ID on the mobile phone, so actually the direction of our ministry is, and our minister, Ms. Trzeżyńska, is to go very much in this direction, to have everything on mobile. So June next year we will be having the mobile ID. To the end of the next year we'll be having all documents on mobile, but limited to the documents needed. Actually, we've been focused on the driver's community in the beginning. So this car connected documents like insurance, driving license, and their car registration. So those documents there will be on mobile very soon, which means next year. So that's the project. The moment we have the projects at that level. Regarding the MasterCards, actually we are running very nice projects together with the Minister of Development in Poland, which is called Paperless Cashless, because this is the main direction which we are following now. So we would like to, within 5 years, that 80% of the people will be able, 50% of the people will be able to interact in 80% with a different e-government systems, and actually complete the job from the beginning to the end, not just to filling the forms, print it out and stuff like this, but from the beginning to the end. And the cashless, we would like also to to decrease the number of cash which is still on our market. At the moment it's approximately 21.5%. We would like to have it in 5 years like 15%. That's the goal. So the project is quite big, and we are also discussing the different options you mentioned with the cards, what services we can put on the cards in the future before we will really print the card with a chip, how it will look like, what services we would like to have it connected, maybe in the cloud, maybe we will put something on the card. So this is discussions we are now in the middle of, but very soon we will present the solutions we will be implementing next years, I hope.
It's going very quickly.
It's yes, I would say that yes, but it's a difficult job because we've been put in the very challenging moment. So we had to make really the change a lot within also from the organizational point of view, from the management point of view. So we changed a lot within the ministry. So actually we changed it also to the projects oriented very much as it is in the business, because we had really to speed up with things which were not done in the past.
Well, I think here, indeed, what Vice Minister De Croo said about people not being on board and the fact that the social innovation has to occur with the technological innovation, and that's actually sometimes the very hardest thing. I see that you're chomping at the bit, but I would like to bring Dr. Floridi back into the discussion, especially since we're talking about trust and distrust and ethics. How are you feeling about the tone of the discussion at this point? I'm feeling a bit of bristling on the back of my neck, to be honest.
Well, I think that we should be moderately optimistic, despite recent events, despite what has happened in the last couple of years. We are making steps forward in terms of what the digital represents for humanity, in terms of, it's a force for good, and it's a major, major sort of improvement that we can definitely use to improve living standards of millions of people and so on. So a pinch of moderate optimism, I think, is justified. In terms of trust, I very much like the idea of having, especially in Europe, a push for more trust. And how do you do that? I mean, there's a quick metaphor, and I guess it's coming just before lunch. Suppose you want to bake some trust. What are the ingredients? Well, the ingredients are really normally three. Credibility. If you're a company, certainly, in terms of a credit card, you better be credible, otherwise trust will not be there. You have to be transparent, because people will trust you if they can see what you're doing. And therefore, in some countries, they can see much better than in other countries what's going on. And therefore, the trust is higher. And then third, accountability, because they need to know that, okay, I can see that you're going to deliver, I can see whether something is going wrong, and I want to know that if something goes wrong, someone is going to pay for it. So you put these three ingredients together in whatever sort of amount you like in your kitchen, and then trust starts developing. Trust doesn't fall out of the sky just because we like it. It's built from bottom up in terms of interactions. So that is a reason for being moderately optimistic. The last point is about pace, because we heard a lot in terms of comments on how everything is fast going and developing. Now, again, not that I want to make everybody feel okay, but if you look not from a distant perspective, the historical long-term perspective, and you compare the revolution we're undergoing to the other major revolutions that humanity has been through, like the agricultural one took millennia to have the effects that we know. And then the industrial one took centuries to reach the kind of level of impact and therefore adaptability of society to it. The digital one has taken one generation. Inevitably, we are wrong-footed. But we should cut some slack now, because we are the generation that will see the transition from the analog to the digital. It will never happen again, like the agriculture and the industrial. And certainly we have a lot of responsibilities. But at the same time, we should be a little bit sort of gentle towards ourselves, because it is a major transformation that is has happened in a matter of decades. More planning is certainly welcome. But at the same time, the pessimism and the lack of trust, because things are not going as well as they could, I think is unjustified.
Okay. With all due respect, in your keynote, you said this is a change that up until now we have not encountered. In fact, you can't measure it against the Industrial Revolution or the Agricultural Revolution. So I don't want us all to get comfortable, actually. That's my job. I see the advent of the Anthropocene era, the end of our planet, the fact that we can now manipulate our own DNA. These are things that are magnitudinal changes that certainly make me a bit ill at ease. I think, and I maintain that technology is actually ambivalent. It's more about what you do with it than any intention that it has in and of its own. But maybe we'll talk about that over lunch. And I think Kaia actually wanted to jump in with a perspective from Estonia.
Well, I just wanted to comment on a few of the things. When we talk about creating the environment, then very often we see in the political debates that actually what is expected from the politicians is to create the suitable business models, or people are talking about different things. We can't do that. So we can make the environment better, and by making this environment better, actually the first question we have to always ask: what is the problem? So what is the problem that we are trying to solve? And very often we just take the rules that are already existing and put them to the new age and try to do the nitty-gritty so that the rules would suit the existing situation. But actually the situation has completely changed, and those things that were the problem before are not the problem now. So we have to constantly ask the question: what is the problem that we are trying to solve? Maybe it's not there, or maybe we don't need any rules. And last, just the last point on the pace of things going forward. I think one is, of course, the speed of changes in everyday life. But when we talk about governments trying to keep up with it, I think the pace is too slow. I was in private practice. I went to the national politics. Then I was amazed how slow things are. But that was Estonian politics. Come on. Then I went to. Came to Brussels, and then it's like
European Parliament.
European Parliament, yeah.
Not
no, but European Parliament, and then I just understand also how different. Stages of development different countries are. When I hear talking about you can put everything on one card, well, you can put we don't have driver's licenses and things, because you have the identity card and they can check from the computer whether you have all these things. Why do you have to have the documents with you? So many things that I already take for granted, and in other parts of Europe they are not there. I understand it's related to the size, but what I also see, what you mentioned about cooperation, collaboration, we don't have that in the European level. We have so many good things in different countries, and we just don't share the best practices, I think.
Maybe on the element about pace. Look, the whole question is how do you give people the tools to go with that pace? And I'm not so afraid that at some point it will go too fast, because whatever technology you develop, it's people who are going to use it. So if it goes too fast for people, at some point there's a disconnect. So technology is always it's just a means too. It's always people using it. So I'm not that afraid about it. But still. How do you make people ready? And there's a lot of discussion about, well, our schooling system, it needs to be more STEM-oriented, and then people translate that into, well, we need tablets in the classrooms and digital writing boards and so on. I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure this is what it is really about. I think the reflection we need to have is, if you have kids in school today, what will be the type of jobs in 15 years where humans still make the difference versus algorithms, robots, and so on. And that reflection, I do not see it happen enough in Europe today. If you think about it, we need to learn people the things that machines will never learn. So a part of it will be analytical thinking. But that's for me only a part of it. A second element will definitely be creativity and so on. But a third element, which we never talk about, is an emotional layer. We humans will always be better in handling emotions than any type of machine. So I think that if you want to make your education ready for in 15, 20 years, I think it is much more about non-technological elements than it is about technological elements. Because the technological elements, well, technology will do that. The question is, where do we have value added? And our value added will be especially in the non-technological elements. And I don't see that in schools at all today. In schools, there is one filtering, and that filtering is analytical thinking, and that's great. But we don't filter on creativity, and we don't filter at all on emotions. You need to see the three of them. Maybe there's other elements too. And it's important, because if you look at those three elements, every kid is strong in at least one of the three. And it's a way of making sure that this digital revolution is something that everyone can be part of. The biggest mistake you could make is that you say, well, the strong analytical thinkers, they will be part of society, and all the rest, we don't really count on you. That would be a gigantic mistake, I think. And so that, obviously, as a liberal, I believe in the market, but that does not mean that the public service has no role to play. We definitely have a role to play, but which I think, as Kaya said, is kind of different than what we did up to now.
I think it's particularly enlightened, and it looks to me that what we have here is a classic distinction between, you know, you have a journey, and you have the pace at which that journey is going, like a car, how fast it's traveling, and then the direction. And how fast it's going doesn't tell you anything about where it is going. It's going fast somewhere. And I think what we just heard, and I like that picture very much, is determining the direction in which we are fast going. We will go fast, but where exactly, are we going to go that way or this other way? For example, in terms of what are we going to do with the jobs? Well, that is crucial sort of socio-political direction setting discussion that we need to have. So I have to say that I'm particularly supportive of what you just mentioned. That seems to me, the right direction.
Now that we're talking about education, though, this is a topic that is particularly close to my own heart, and especially about digital inclusion and what we're missing out on when we're not looking at creativity and emotional intelligence, bringing in all the sectors of society. And here I'd like to just toss in a couple of statistics for the discussion. One is that 48% of Europeans are low or non-skilled digitally. That's 48%. So as my idol Nelly Cruz said, I bring back, social innovation will eat technological innovation for lunch. So indeed, this area of discussion is quite enthralling. And in fact, this is where the laggards start lagging. So those countries in Europe that are in the head of the DESI index, the areas where they are not growing are all of the non-technological areas. So human capital, use of internet actually by people, not connectivity, not broadband expansion. It's all the rest of those kind of softer elements. And I'd like to maybe look at, if we can break that down a bit. Obviously, tackling education is very important, but very difficult. Stimulating innovation and stimulating the private sector from the ground up to digitize with everyone on board. Can you jump in and give some insight?
Yeah, sure. So the private sector, especially in Poland, they are doing the job. So they are pretty much convinced that the digital revolution will help them, that they see the benefits. From the education perspective, so in our government, regarding the program, is a Minister of Education, but as a Minister of Digital Affairs, we are trying to help them to at least provide them with a tool and access to the digital world. So at the moment we are running the project where we are connecting 32,000 schools to the high-speed internet, so it will be done very soon. So actually we see that point and we have it in mind on our market. And also what is important for us, we have from the connectivity perspective, we have also quite a lot of local problems when we see that we might need the support from the European Union, for example, like the 700 megahertz harmonization. So we are on the border, on the European border. We are talking about 5G in the future, this direction which should be in 2020, 2022, that's the time frame. But we have to really be involved at the moment with a discussion with, for example, Ukraine and Russia, how they are using this frequency, which is going very much deeply into our country, almost to the middle of the country. And Russia is using on this frequency the military services and Ukraine television. So if you really would like to go in 5G and have the same conditions within the Europe, we need to really do something with these problems as well together. So they are very basic problems we are facing, but it's, they are because of our geographic position. Also, what we see, what is important, because since morning we are discussing very much the digital transformation, the single market, digital single market, which should be the obvious continuation. But we see that we are still in Europe very much fragmented in different areas within the digital space. This is also something which we should take care of very soon, I hope. So I mean this harmonization, roaming problems and roaming charges problems, free flow of data, which is still very important problem, I would say. As we know, in the future, everything will be about data. So we should now think maybe not where to store the data, but how, yes? That's if they are safe, if they are secure, and from the business perspective, it is okay, we can keep them whenever we want within the Europe, yes? That's the foundation for me of the single digital market. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of areas which I would like also to bring to the discussion, because this is very important from my perspective and from the perspective what we will be doing in the future as country.
Well, I really like that you brought in the geopolitical question,
which is the
killer app, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, if this doesn't work out, there's no digital single market,
exactly.
There's no single market, period. But I noticed that you also took the discussion back to the deployment of the technology and the infrastructure, whereas Poland has a lot of challenges with brain drain and just losing people, and we haven't yet then
exactly.
taken up that discussion of reaching, so you get the high speed, get the broadband to the schools, but how do you get the teachers on board? How do you get the kids on board? But let's tackle
yes,
that in another series. Also from the public sector perspective, though, what you have a human challenge in terms of skills, jobs that are going unfilled. So yes, we can talk and dream about the digital society, but indeed without the human component on board, what do you have to talk about in terms of, you know, this other layer of the digital environment, but the digital environment populated by humans who can actually do the work required in the digital environment?
No, absolutely, and I think the points have already been made in terms of education and infrastructure investment. I think from our perspective, there's very much a need and a drive to bring full inclusion. And when we talk about inclusion, the inclusion agenda, this is one whereby as a force for good, globally, what we look to do is actually bring products and services that will actually benefit society and will actually allow consumers the ability to interact electronically, purchase goods electronically, actually be able to very much behave as you would expect in a developed society. And I think from our perspective, what we've looked to do is develop services, solutions with governments, with public sector, that will actually bring those to all facets of society. You know, some of the societal products and propositions that we're currently working on with charities like Save the Children, with refugee products. These, again, are meeting a need which is there in the environment, which, again, obviously from our perspective, is one about bringing those new consumers into the ecosystem, being able to allow them to actually behave and actually drive the use of products and solutions as you would expect in a developed world.
Okay, this is a nice entry point, I think, to digital as an opportunity for inclusion.
I wanted to comment on the skills and education part. In Estonia, we have this obligation of all the teachers to show what digital tools they use in their subjects. So no matter what is the subject, then there is a lot of complaining. Also from some teachers, for example, one teacher of biology complained that, you know, I have to show what kind of digital tools I've used, but nobody asked me how many times I took the children to the forest. I teach biology. So that leads me to the point that you made as well, that On the digital issues, actually, computers are almost always better than the humans. So there is this conflict also that how much digital tools we allow the children to use, because it's the way we communicate and understand emotions that actually gives us jobs later on. And if you see the youngsters only on their mobiles, then actually just look into the eyes of your classmates and talk to them, because you need that skill in the future. And what comes to the low skills, that 49% of people actually have low skills in digital. What we did also study, and that's also about these people who are not very experienced in the digital environment and don't have skills. And what was the most interesting about this was that the people with the lowest skills don't want to just have any kind of training of those skills. So the question was that do you feel that you need improvement of your skills? And they said that we don't want that. So it relates to the fear as well. But you fear the unknown. So how to make those people actually learn these things? So the problem is that they don't want to. How to show that you have to have these skills, otherwise you don't survive. And a last point on the jobs. I think we should also, on the political level, take the discussion from the jobs level to the employment level, because I'm also part of the Robotics and Artificial Intelligence Working Group in the European Parliament. And what is interesting is that the way people work nowadays, it's the ideal. The rules are made for one long-term contract with one employer, but actually the people don't work like this anymore. They don't. They have multiple contracts. They have short-term contracts. The enterprise is the average lifespan of an enterprise or a company is 15 years. So it's much shorter now. Mm-hmm. So actually, and when we talk about social security, it's still related to a job. And we always talk about, you know, creating jobs, how many jobs these things create, whereas the people live in a totally different world.
Mm-hmm. That's a really, I really appreciate that distinction. I guess we can talk about skills then, mm-hmm. because an individual who has the right skill set is ready for any kind of work. And since Belgium is one of those countries that's lagging, and that it is this particular area that is a challenge now, I think, across the board, but even for the ones who were the leaders heretofore. If you had a magic wand, Minister De Croo, and could say...
A magic
wand, or a baguette, or a banana.
I just have unlimited powers.
Something magical, yes. In Belgium, no less. What would be like the key things that you would say, I would want to see this, and this?
Well, to just start with very actionable things, what I find surprising is that when I was in high school almost 20 years ago, I learned to code. And today, in most high schools, you don't, which I find very strange. So we used to do that, and now where it is actually much more important, it's not part of the curriculum itself. Very, very strange. In Belgium. I think that what you need to do is to give the schools much more latitude in that. I think it's a bit an utopic idea to try to define centrally what are the different elements that every kid needs to learn. I think you need to be clear on what the objectives are. And then every school has great teachers who are ambitious, who want to do things. Give them more freedom. I think if you give them more freedom, they will be more motivated in being innovative as well. And it will give the parents also a choice in which direction to go. But I think you need to be clear on saying, well, the basics of coding is for everyone. Because what has changed in the way you use technology is that I have the feeling that we, 20 years ago, were much more often in a creation mode in using technology, whereas if I look at kids today, they are much more in a consumer mode. They use technology, but they don't use it to make something themselves, which is kind of odd, actually, because it's going to be the basic building block in anything you do. That is on the the education side. And I think that, look, we always say kids need to be more, know what happens in society, and they need to do internships and all these things. Mm-hmm. That's great. But it's, I mean, you can ask them to do an internship for 1 month if the other months they spent in a classroom with a teacher who never leaves his class, mm-hmm. his classroom. So why would we not use at least one of the two summer holiday months to make sure that our teachers also do internships in the real world? You know where this the summer holiday comes from. I mean, the summer holiday comes from the fact that more than 100 years ago, during July and August, the kids were supposed to help on the farm. That's where it comes from. Well, that's not the case anymore today, so maybe we can do something more creative with it. I'm not abolishing the summer holidays, please.
No, it's, I was just going to say,
don't tweet
it's
that.
It's also where voting on November 2nd on Tuesday came in the U.S. from
that's
voting on
Tuesday. But there's a lot of habits we have which come from I would say, ancient needs. Still, I think on the school side, there's things we can do better, but things are going in the right direction. I think the big challenge is the current working population. And we've seen the financial institutions doing huge layoffs because their business model is changing. And it, I mean, you can't stop that. We are not going to banks anymore. So at some point, you don't need physical banks anymore. So jobs are changing. That's just the way it goes. The creation of jobs, of course, is often on a more fragmented scale, but it's happening. But there is a huge stigma today where you basically say someone who's 50 year old can never be part of the digital society. I don't agree at all with that. I think most of them in their private lives actually use the digital society all over. But then when they go to their job, instead of being in the 21st century in their private life, they come in the 20th century on their jobs. And when they work in the Justice Department, they are in the 18th century or something like that. That's for the Belgians. But the idea that this is something only for the young people is false. I think it's completely false. But it will not go by itself. And I think in any European country, making sure that everyone has the basic skills to participate in a digital society is something where I think the public sector needs to lead the way, but cannot do it by itself. You cannot expect public service to do that by itself, but it can be a huge enabler. And if you look, for example, we have these gigantic Juncker funds, which we try to do useful things with. If you look at what it's used for, it's mostly used for infrastructure investment. And I think that's wrong. I think that's plain wrong, because infrastructure investment, the private sector can do it if you create a stable environment. And I think the new infrastructure is skills and competencies. That's the new infrastructure. And I do not see that in where we are allocating today. And it should be together with the private sector and so on, but you cannot expect the private sector to do the investments in skills and jobs for a population that the time frame is much shorter there. And so I'm a bit disappointed. And we can say, well, you know, the next European Commission will do it. Mm-hmm. Yes, maybe, but every year that you lose is a big issue, I think. So I would just count on my European colleagues to get things moving.
I was going to say that. Now you have the mission, but I think it's clear if we start to see these trends that the infrastructure is there, but the infrastructure we can't do anything with the infrastructure without the human component on board. And if our leading economies start to lag because of that human component, then indeed it demands a readjustment or reprioritization of the budgeting and funding mechanisms. And I know you're working on that right now, right,
Ms. Kallas? But I think it's vice versa as well. When we have very skilled people, but we don't have the infrastructure, we don't have the internet access or connections in the far rural areas, then it's also a problem. So we need to have both.
Okay.
That's true, but you have, I mean, mobile networks are being built all over sub-Saharan Africa with private money, almost no government money, and it's being built because it's profitable, and I guess profit is a good thing, then if we can do it in Rwanda, then why would you need government money to do it in the south of Italy? I mean, I cannot be convinced of this. Mm-hmm. And you need to be creative in sometimes creating a short-term monopoly to make sure that the private sector can get their money back. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That is a different thing.
No, I agree with this. Again, there are very big cultural differences. When we talked about roaming, for example, it came very clearly that in parts where there are like parts of Finland, that if you look at Finland and their area and how they only have 5 million people and how good connections are and how low prices are, whereas some areas of Europe where the investment could pay off much better, the investments are just not made. And maybe because the governmental subsidies have slowed the things down because they don't let the market work. But of course it's a big discussion.
Well, I think we raised the question of the evolution of the financial institutions. Clearly, school is evolving. Schools, education itself is evolving as well. I'm a prime example of that. What about our public the rest of our public institutions evolving? Looking into the digital future, how irrelevant is this discussion going to become of nation states, of regions, of geopolitical blocks? Yes.
Good point. I mean, I think if we look at how we got here, there's a tendency to look at the state, say, Estonia, UK, Belgium, as the end point. I mean, they are the citizens, and then maybe they are organized in some ways, then maybe the political parties, maybe they are institutions, and then there's finally, the top of the mountain is the state. And I think that comes from our sort of 19th century, 20th century perspective, where the state was sort of the ultimate organizing institution. Today, if we want to look at the 21st century, we really need to look at the state as an interface between the local and the global. And I know it sounds a little bit of a slogan, but inevitably, the national state will be there to negotiate between the local requirements, needs, which may be very specific, ad hoc, of a particular region or even an ethnic group, and the global challenges or the global needs or the global sort of opportunities. Now, if you start looking at the state as sort of the sort of Westphalian modern institution as reinvented as an interface between the local and the global, then the state has a lot to do for good. But if the state is the ultimate sort of end point, well, then we know that we're living in the past. So in that sense, unfortunately, for some people, Europe is the solution because that is where the state can collaborate with other states and have that magnifying interface role whereby the local interest and the global needs and challenges find a mediation. Now, how can we possibly ever going to get all together around the same table if that mediation role is no longer there, played by any sort of state or supranational sort of organization like the European Commission, the EU? I just cannot understand philosophically, historically, that is not the way things are architecturally organized. Now, whether this is something that is sort of controversial to some ears, I'm afraid that that's the open-minded attitude that we need to have in the world. But in that sense, I believe that what you just mentioned in terms of the role of the state is obsolete if you look at the modern state, but it's actually cutting edge in terms of what the state can do for the future. That seems to me where we're going to play the right or the wrong hand in this particular digital game that we're having.
Yeah. Very interesting. Yeah.
If I may comment, I agree with this generally, but there's one problem, and that is the public. and what we see in different countries is rising nationalism. Actually, it's stronger than ever before. What we see in the European Parliament as well, that often the members of parliament just speak about their national interest. Like there are very few that actually talk about, European interests. And if I would just imagine if you would go with this idea to a general public that you know this is obsolete and that the states are not necessary anymore, and which is all true because the challenges are global and everything, I just think that the people will not follow this idea and they rather want a more national approach in everything, what we see in different discussions.
Let's maybe park that discussion there. I think it could go on for days, and things will definitely be evolving in the coming weeks and months in terms of geopolitical reality. I would just toss out there that you might check out something called bitnation.co. If you're fed up with the geopolitical environment, you can go start your own country if you want. I have one. Actually, I'm an embassy in Belgium. I'm an ambassador in the BitNation. So that's the opportunity that digital brings us, right? When we don't find it here, maybe all those 62 million American voters who will not be, who are not happy about the situation, will all just form up their own digital country and abandon the rest of the U.S. But I think we have a unique opportunity here to also field some questions from you. We've opened a lot of channels of discussion. We haven't even talked about the role of startup enterprise and innovation and the role of digital in that part of the environment, jobs, specific careers that we might be zooming in on. I see a hand over here. If you can, is there a microphone? If you can just please tell us who you are before you ask your question.
Hello, my name is Mona Hatta. I'm from JADE, the European Confederation of Junior Enterprises. And especially there, I wanted to step in and ask, what are the key factors for success that you see, especially for young entrepreneurs in the digital future?
Mm-hmm. Chris, do you want to take this maybe?
Yeah. Difficult question, yeah, because to check, we are using different indexes. We've been mentioned already, like DESI. We are looking very much on the Global Innovation Index done by Cornell University, which is also very good place to use that. But in the end of the day, we will measure that with a number of entrepreneurs which will be developing the businesses within Europe and our country. That's the result we would like to see in the end.
Anyone else want to take up the question of youth and entrepreneurship?
Just to make sure, the question was more of an advice on the individual level, or look, I think it's never been easier than today to be an entrepreneur. The threshold of entry has never been lower than today. When I previously they explained us that you needed a nice business plan and it needed to have nice colors and nice slides, and then you could start. That's not how it works today. How it works today is you can pull something together, which is a minimum viable product, and you try to convince people, and you get going. And you actually can do that because there's so many things you can get on the tap, and you don't have to buy things. And the sharing economy, of which we haven't talked yet, I think is a great thing. It opens up markets which used to be very small markets. Having your own driver, having someone who comes to cook at your home. These were very small markets limited to people with a lot of money. Today it's opening up for everyone. But it's especially also on the other side. People start to taste entrepreneurship in a very easy way. And if you look in the United States, the number of people who through the sharing platforms become entrepreneurs, who they are people who before would never have gotten half a euro of funding money. Because they don't have the right diploma, because they don't have the right background, because they live on the wrong side of the city. And actually, a lot of them find out that they're good at entrepreneurship and they get going. That's great. The more people can try it out, the better it is. So I would just say, don't talk about it. Do it. And I see I mean, conferences like this are great, and I hope for the organizers that people keep coming to these conferences. But for yourselves, I think just a few is enough. And instead of listening and talking about it, if you're interested in entrepreneurship, just get going. I mean, it's about doing things. It's not about talking about things. And the opportunity for doing things today are much broader than they have ever been.
And I agree more from our perspective. We have an entrepreneurial start path business line, and that really is there to support entrepreneurs Europe-wide, globally, and really work with them on particular ideas, give guidance, put our own solutions to play as well. So again, happy to pick that up and have that conversation. Cool.
Well, this is an agreement and indictment. In Belgium, only 3% of tech starters are women. So if you're a woman in Belgium and want to be a tech starter, you can talk to me. But it's kind of it comes back to, I think, what Kaya was saying about the fear factor and the ones who don't want to start. So please listen to what the minister has to say.
Just add one point, which is what we said about education is linked to this risk-loving attitude. If you start educating kids in terms of, unless you know, you really hurt yourself, you haven't quite played hard enough, which is exactly, forgive me for the moment of self-referential stuff, what we teach our students in Oxford, then you know that they will not go out and take some risks and enjoy the fact that they failed, because there will be other risks and other challenges. But that is the kind of education that we need to instill. And in some corners, and I remember Italy, this is exactly the opposite of what we teach them. No, safety of a permanent full-time job where you possibly run zero risks. That is the education that most of the kids get, at least in that country.
I saw another hand over there. Yes.
Thank you very much. Nicolas Sodach with IBM. A question for Minister De Croo and Mr. Schubert. You spoke about trust, and you spoke about the need to talk about the benefits of data. We've spoken a lot about data protection and the challenges around data. Both of your countries are pioneering a group of member states to have a positive discussion around the free flow of data here in Europe. You're a large group, but we see a number of countries on the other side, most notably France, Germany also, and your French counterpart, Axel Le Maire, made some very serious statements about data localization within France, etc. What would you react to those reactions, to those things that are being said out of France and Germany? And then a second question, if those countries do not agree with the need to remove data localization, would you actually support a mini digital single market amongst your D15 or whatever group it is, to send the signal that you as countries amongst each other trust each other with your data? Thank you.
Yeah, I think it's a group of 9 countries, which I heard informally is called the digital cool kids or something like that, which is nice to be part of. Well, at least we have the European Commissioner on our side. Commissioner Ansip from Estonia again is completely on the line of free flow of data. Look, the whole idea of data localization is, from a technological perspective, a very dated idea. So the idea that if my data is in one place in my own country, it is safe, that's completely the opposite. I mean, I hope, if data is important, I would hope that it is localized in at least 3 or 4 different parts of the world, just to make sure that if something happens, that you have a copy somewhere. The whole idea that if you have your own data center in your basement, you're safe, is completely opposite to the idea of encryption and so on. What you see is that obviously the countries who are in favor of free flow of data, in general smaller countries, open economies, who benefit from trade. And so the discussion about free flow of data is part of a broader discussion. And that broader discussion is people start to doubt the benefits of trade. Kaya talked about nationalism. Well, economic nationalism is all over the place. Our Belgian post is trying to take over the Dutch post. That's quite an adventure. When it goes the other way around, it's never a problem. when it's going in this direction, it's a big, big, big problem. But economic protectionism is coming back. And the discussion about free flow of data, this is the essence of one market. Roaming, I think, was a great decision and showed that we see this as one market. But if we see data, which is the new call of the call of the new economy, as something that you could limit movement, then I think we're really not creating the single market. Now, am I saying that there could be no exception? I can understand that for some elements which are crucial to national security, there could be exceptions. That I agree. But after that exception, they says, well, you know, maybe data related to energy and then maybe data related to financial services. And then, well, in the end, you just decide that there is no free movement of data. Okay, if we still have to prove that trade is good, we've come a long way. But it seems that we need some economics 101 classes in Europe.
So let's build that digital wall. I'm afraid that we are out of time, unfortunately. The member of European Parliament and I'm sure the minister need to leave us. But for that second question, perhaps you can catch up.
I'd like to thank you very much for the first question, because it's actually the discussion regarding free flow of data is again here. So this Friday we will be a meeting here. There will be an informal meeting of the hopefully 16 countries from the like-minded group, the countries which are thinking very similar within the digital space. We will be talking about the free flow of data. And actually the point is that we will be discussing not where the data is located, but how. Yeah, that's the main message we will be trying to push and follow. So that's the short comment on the question. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Schubert. Thank you, Mr. Goodrich, and Dr. Floridi, Madame Callas, and Minister De Croo. And thank you all for staying with us on behalf of Think Digital. We'll see you again, hopefully, next year.
Thank you.